Birdland, the home of the new progressive jazz called bebop. Developed first by trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie and his second-in-command, alto saxophonist Charlie Parker. Featuring angular melodies, complex harmonies, and hypnotic solos. It was as difficult for the musicians to play as the audience to understand.
The Palladium was a couple of blocks removed from Birdland, and that was the mecca of the jazz world. So musicians would move back and forth to check each other out.
In the radius of probably three blocks, there were all the innovations probably that had happened in America in the last 50 years. It was like an incubator, spawning team. That's where everybody came to New York. If they loved bebop, they went to Birdland. If you wanted the right night, you'd go into the Palladium. It's an amazing time. I was like a kid. I was like Dracula at the Blood Bank. I was so excited. Every minute there was something to see.
Mongo and Eddie and Tito and Ray Barreto, who all love jazz. See, that's the key. The jazz musicians loved Latin music, and the Latin musicians loved jazz. So you would get Bird and Dizzy and Miles Davis and Thelonious Monk, and all the great stars would always find their way up there because the music was so exciting and so dynamic.
The marriage has always been there. They understood each other perfectly. It's almost like double-time brass licks, you know, over this serious polyrhythmic rhythm section. And it's just like a train that you couldn't stop.
Dizzy Gillespie, Dexter Gordon, Stan Getz, Zoot Sims, these are all people that I saw actually playing solos with Machito's band.
You listen to the music of certain jazz things from the late 40s and 50s and even into the early 60s, you'll see many Latin devices in the music.
That's what happened with Cal Jada. He's playing with George Shearing. Al McKibben tells him, hey, let's go across the street. Tito Puente is playing at the Palladium. Oh, yeah. He goes over there. He sees Tito Puente playing vibes. He goes, wow, man, vibes in Latin music, in Afro-Cuban music. What happens? Caljero becomes a mambo nick.
Dizzy Gillespie, who was responsible mostly for this Latin jazz movement many years in the 40s, when he had this great Chano Pozo, and he did this great standard called a Manteca, which everybody knows. And he did all kinds of jazz things that they always had that Latin rhythmic pattern involving.
Jazz was the maximum of harmonic structure. That's what was being fed to the conscientious Latin player. For example, how that influenced Rene Hernandez, who was the arranger of the Machito Orchestra when he comes from Cuba, when he hears Stan Kenton, when he hears Dizzy Gillespie, when he hears Count Basie's band. Wow, you know, and then he incorporates that naturally because of the jazz harmonic structures to the Machito Orchestra. That's why the orchestra and its recordings were just unmatchable and, you know, and the greatest orchestra we've ever had.
Renowned for his complex arrangements, Mario discovered a talent who took arranging for the Machito band to the highest level, Chico O'Farrell, considered by many the greatest arranger in the history of African-Cuban music. Mario and Machito had another secret weapon, Machito's sister, Graciela, the grand dame of balladeers.
Afro-Cuban and jazz music has always been married at the hip, always. they couldn't help it because it's about the same thing. They love very hip harmonies, very hip rhythmical values, and complex rhythmic values.
The old songs that came out of Cuba, the standards, the Vacilones and the Monkeys, Wapacha, the beginnings of Cha-Cha-Cha and stuff like that, were very simple, had very simple lyrical content and musical content, too. Basically, there are two or four chords, and the lyrics were mostly a baila, a gozar, I want to dance, I want to have a good time, come out with me tonight, dance with me. I love you, baby. You know, that was it. And what was happening is the musicians, the New York Latin musicians, would come around and they would start as we used to jam. Instead of playing straight triads or six chords, we were now going to ninths and augmented 13th chords and 11th chords and substitute chordal systems to expand the harmonies and to be able to play more creative improvisations, more creative music, a kind of mixture of jazz and Latin music together.
New York took on a kind of life of its own compared to music that was traditionally strictly from Cuba or strictly from Puerto Rico.
Tito had just started his big band, and he would use Doc Severinsen, he would use Al Kahn and Zoot Sims, and you know, a lot of the jazz guys, Cannibal Adderley, and they would cross over into the Latin scene, and then Tito would reciprocate and play on their albums.
It was a cross-pollinization of one another, and I think the Latins got plenty from the jazzers, and the jazzers got plenty from the Latins.
No jazzer got more than Dizzy Gillespie, who went to his mentor, Mario Bauza, looking for the African-Cuban sound for his own band.
The story goes that Dizzy was talking to Mario, saying, you know, Cuban rhythms, man, it's so, you know, it's so deep, there's so many different variations, and the rhythm that we use in jazz is pretty limited, you know, it's just swing, you know, a couple of variations of that, two beat and four beat feels, but that's it. How could we make the rhythm in jazz more interesting? Mario said, man, you just use Latin rhythms. And he said, I know this conga player in Cuba who is a consummate performer, and you've got to meet him. He's a friend of mine. His name's Chano Pozo.
Renowned as a composer, dancer, master percussionist, and showman, Chano was also well-versed in the West African-based religious traditions of Santeria, Palo, and Abapua. For the first time, jazz was enlivened with African chants and Chano's own explosive drumming.
When a musician like Chano Pozo comes to New York, a proud, dark-skinned Cuban, proud of his African roots and asserting those African roots in the music, it spoke to the American jazz musicians on a level that no one had before. Dizzy Gillespie made a comment. I didn't speak Spanish, and Chano Pozo didn't speak English. But that didn't matter, because together we spoke African.
Like two long-lost brothers separated by slavery, Dizzy and Chano reunited the rhythmic roots of jazz and African-Cuban music in their masterpiece, Manteca.
Dizzy Gillespie's exploration into Afro-Cuban music was really an exploration into his own African roots. We'll be right back.
The belated musicians were also exploring, hoping to cross over to the respect and riches of mainstream America.